whoremongers and adulterers. God's judgment against whoremongers and adulterers. Number three, great joy for matrimony without adultery. Great joy for matrimony without adultery. Number one, God's justification for marriage without adultery. We're looking at chapter 13 of Hebrews, verse 4. Marriage is honorable in all. In the sight of God, marriage is honorable. Actually, God himself has made marriage honorable from the day of creation. If you look at Genesis chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 18. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. It says, and the Lord said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make and help meet for him. In that place, God made marriage honorable. And God beautified marriage. And he said, it is not good that the man had not fallen. He was a pure man, a holy man, a righteous man, a perfect man. But the Lord said, this holy man will not be complete without marriage. And this righteous man will not be complete without marriage. And this a perfect man will not be complete without marriage. This is not good for this holy, righteous, perfect man that you should be alone. I will make and help meet for him. Not only that the man was rich, because all the things in the world belong to him. He had a great accommodation, the Garden of Eden. Nothing as beautiful as the Garden of Eden. And he said, it is not good that this rich man, this prosperous man, and this contented man, it's not good that he should be alone. I will make and help meet for him. He was a happy man. He was a healthy man. You know, some people say, what do I need a wife for? I'm righteous, I'm holy, I'm perfect, I'm sanctified. This man was sanctified and holy. Some people say, I'm so rich, what do I need somebody for? Do I need any help? Because I have all the money I need, I have all the accommodation I need. And Adam had all that. And God made marriage honorable in his life. In fact, Adam did not even know he had the need. You know, sometimes you don't know you have a need, and God is saying, you have the need. And then you look around and say, God, why do I need a wife? Why do I need a husband? When I'm this, and that. God knows more than we know. I said, God knows more than we know. And then we're told at the end of the story, look at verse 24, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother. It was at that time that God now said, marriage is not only going to be for Adam, it's going to be for the whole race. It's going to be for all his offsprings. And then he says, man shall leave father and mother. It's not talking about Adam now, because Adam did not have a father. Adam did not have a mother. He's talking about all the people that will come after. All the people that will follow after. And he said, they will leave father and mother and shall be joined unto his wife. And they shall be what? One flesh. Let's look at Matthew, as the Lord Jesus Christ came to the world thousands of years after that Old Testament is gone now. We're now at the beginning of the New Testament and the New Age. And the Lord now brought back again to mind what he had said, what had been done before. Matthew chapter 19, reading from verse 4. And he answered and said unto them, have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning, made them male and female, he went back to the beginning. And he said, he was still upholding marriage, the sacredness of marriage, and the godliness that ought to be in the family, and that he made them male and female. That means no polygamy. Now that even there are many men in the world and many women in the world, you're not entitled to many, but just one, because he made them male and female. In verse 5, and said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Shall cleave to his wife. Psychologically, you're cleaving to the wife. Spiritually, you're cleaving to the wife. And physically, you're cleaving to the wife. And naturally, you're cleaving to the wife. You're not allowing any separation in your mind, any separation in your thought, any separation in your affection. You love one another. Wherefore, they are no more twain, but one flesh. The Lord is saying that they even think alike, and eventually they might even be looking alike. Not they are also planning alike, and they have the same mind and the same heart and the same direction in life, because now they are one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, tell me the rest. Let no man put asunder what the Lord has joined together. He's saying you should not put asunder. Let no man put asunder. You know, sometimes it's a little problem that husband and wife that they're having, and then there is a lawyer somewhere that is saying, I can help you out, I can help you with divorce, I can help you with separation. The Lord is saying, let no lawyer put them asunder. Sometimes a coach that is saying that, well, what the challenges you are having, I think, you know, for you to have peace of mind and himself to have peace of mind, it's good that you separate what God has joined together. Let no man put asunder. Sometimes it's your mother, sometimes it's your father that comes to that house and says, why are you here? What are you still doing here? If you're still my daughter, follow me now. No, you cannot do that, daddy, because it says what God has joined together, let no man and let no woman put asunder. And when we believe the word of God and remain in the word of God, we're not going to allow separation, we're not going to allow divorce in Jesus' name. And thank God, those who are married here, your families are staying together. And our families will remain together in Jesus' name. And if you're still planning marriage, you're not planning marriage for just a temporary time, a short time. You're planning it for the rest of your life. And when that good woman, when that good man comes into your life, you're going to stay together until the end of your lives in Jesus' name. We're looking at Malachi chapter 2. Malachi chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 14. Malachi chapter 2, verse 14. Yet you say, wherefore, because the Lord has been witness between thee and the wife of thy youth, against whom thou hast dealt treacherously, yet is she thy companion, and she is the wife of thy covenant. The Lord was challenging the people of Israel, and they began to be careless with their marriages. A lot of things came into their lives. Maybe their jobs became the priority, or maybe the friends they were having, husband and wife, you know, husband goes to work in a place, wife goes to work in another place, and the friends they have, the companions they have, or the co-workers they have, they became the priority of their lives. Some relationships outside the home became the very center of their lives. And the Lord is saying, you are dealing treacherously against one another. And he said, in spite of all that, yet she is thy companion, and yet she is the wife of thy covenant. And did not he make one? Yet had he the residue of the spirit, and wherefore one, that he might seek a godly seed. That's the reason why, that's one of the reasons he wants a godly seed, that you have children. And the children are not like animals that are just born into the world and then they go their way, and they're like birds flying out of the nest and then you never see them anymore. It says over here that it is to raise up a godly seed. That's the reason why we have married. That's the reason why we have family, so that you'll be able to raise up the godly seed. You're finding in the world today that broken homes are really having a heavy toll on the children. The children cannot find which way to go anymore. Daddy is away or mommy is away. And then you have one spouse that is raising the children. That's not the will of God. It says that he might seek a godly seed. Therefore, take heed to your spirit. And that let none deal treacherously against the wife of his youth. For the Lord God of Israel says that, what does he say? Tell me. Say it aloud. He hateth putting away. There are theologians that will try to go around the word of God and they pick up adultery or fornication and say, because of this, the Lord has allowed you to put away your wife. God hates putting away. Other people will say, well, you are married, but not from experience now. You can see that you are not compatible. And because of that incompatibility, maybe you need to separate so that you have peace of mind and live your life. And the Lord is saying he hates pushing away. There's some people that say that marriage brings you into bondage. That, you know, you cannot sing the way you want and go where you want and have the liberty and do whatever it is you want to do. Therefore, if you see that your future is at stake, and your whatever it is you want to do in the future, everything is at stake. Why don't you just separate and become free and become independent? Independence will give you everything you want to do in life. God is saying he hates putting away. As we come together, husband and wife, he wants you to remain married until death do you part. For the Lord, the God of Israel, says that he hated putting away. For one covereth violence with his garment, says the Lord of hosts. Therefore, take heed to your spirit, that ye deal not treacherously. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. And here we're looking at the New Testament is telling us now that the reason why, one of the reasons why we get married, one is to have partnership, because the Lord said it's not good for the man to be alone. If it is not good for the man to be alone, it is not good for the woman too, the weaker vessel, to be alone. It is for partnership. It is for protection. To protect your life and to protect you spiritually, to protect you in every way. You know, sometimes you don't know the dangers that you face all alone. You know, you are here, you are there, you don't understand, and then you say, I'm strong. Well, Samson was strong too. I am wise. Solomon was wise too. I am powerful. David was powerful too. For your protection, it says it's not good for the man or for the woman to be alone. Now for purity, so that your life will remain pure, your life will remain holy and sanctified. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 2, nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let, how many people? Tell me again. I make you to say that so you remember that you are part of the people we are talking of. Every man, every woman, let every man have his own wife, your own, that you're not sharing with anybody. This is your own. And let every woman have her own husband. A lot of problems will be solved in your life when you follow that injunction of the Lord. A lot of problems will be solved in the family. A lot of problems will be solved in society. And in the church. When we follow this, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. There are times that unnecessary delay in the church will generate other problems in the church. And we don't understand why we have this problem. Somebody is having depression. Why? You know, it's alone and he just needs a companion. Somebody is having this, you know, kind of discouragement, and sometimes he wants to be in church, and sometimes he's not in church, and sometimes it's just like, you know, everything is empty. Sometimes it's like, what am I in the world for? And you cannot get the source. And the Lord is saying, what you need is a companion. What you need is a partner. What you need is to be able to have some protection over your life. Two are better than one, because when one falls, the other will be able to raise him up. Look at verse 9. It says, but if they cannot contain, let them marry. For it is better to marry than to do what? Than to burn. You know, there are times when you have some desires and passion, and the passion is almost driving you crazy, almost driving your life in a negative direction. And the Lord is saying, why don't you get married? Or you say, I'm still waiting. Why are you waiting? Because somebody came, and you say, well, that's not good enough. What are you looking at? You're looking at the physical. You're looking at the external. And the Lord is saying, but I sent her to you. I sent him to you. Why are you doing like that? So that you'll be able to settle your life. The Lord is, you know, helping. And he says, this is yours. You say, no, that one is not beautiful enough in the outward. It's not what you see on the outside. It's what is inside that matters. Look at verse 39. The wife is bound by the law as long as her husband liveth. But if her husband be dead, she is at liberty to be married. Tell me the next thing. To whom she will. Not to whom the pastor wills. Not to whom the committee wills. To whom she will. Only in the Lord. All we can find out, is she born again? If she's born again, well, that's all we'll find out. The rest is in your hand. Is the man born again? You say, I'm seeing the will of God to this man. All we check up is that be not unequal yoke together with unbelievers. And we will find out, is she born again? Is he born again? Once he's born again and she is born again, the rest is in your hand. You can be married to whom you will. You are the one to pray. You are the one to find the will of God. And you are the one to say, this is how I I am led. And maybe the way you are led is not the way the Lord has been leading me. The way you are led, maybe it's a dream, and I don't depend on dreams. Maybe the way you are led is just that I just love her, and I know that this is the will of God. And then I cannot tell you that that's not enough. How do I know that's not enough? You are the one God is leading. All we can check up in the committee, all we can check up as pastors in the church is that, is the man born again? Is the woman born again? Then you go ahead, the decision is yours. And the consequence of that decision is yours as well. And we're looking at chapter 7 of Romans. Romans chapter 7. And I read from verse 2. For the woman which has an husband is bound by the law to her husband, so long as he liveth. But if the husband be dead, she is loosed from the law of her husband. So then, if while her husband liveth, she be married to another, she shall be called, what? An adulteress. If the husband is still alive, not boyfriend. Somebody had boyfriend before, and you know, whatever happened, they have one child or have whatever number of children, but they were never married. It's talking about marriage here. Somebody properly got married, and the husband is still alive, and the fellow says, I want to marry you. Say, no, I'll preach your husband, go back to your husband. Because while the husband is still alive, if you marry her, you are marrying an adulteress, and you become an adulterer. But if her husband be dead, she is free from the law, from that law, so that she is no more adulteress, though she be married to another. That's the word of the Lord. I pray God will help us to abide by that word in Jesus' name. God honors marriage. He will honor your marriage. And he makes the family godly, he'll make your family godly. We come to point number 2 now. Point number 2, God's judgment against whoremongers and adulterers. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13, we're looking at verse 4. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers, God will judge. I want to look at this section of God's judgment against whoremongers and adulterers. And I want you to understand, normally when you read the Bible, and when theologians preach, or when people who have studied the Bible to some extent, when they preach, they divide life or time into three segments. Number one, the time before the law. Before the law of Moses. That was a great period. Number two, during the time of the law. Number three, the time dispensation of grace. And many preachers will tell us that what happens at the time of dispensation of grace is very different from what happened during the time of the law. But as you look at this problem of adultery, of immorality, of uncleanness, of infidelity, as you look at this period of this point of infidelity and impurity before the law and during the law and the dispensation of grace, we are going to find that God is angry with adultery and fornication every period. And no matter which period we are living in, you need to understand that God hates adultery. He hates fornication. Let's go before the law. Before the law in Genesis chapter 20. Genesis chapter 20. We're looking at it from verse 2. And Abraham said of Sarah, his wife, she is my sister. And Abimelech king of Gerar sent and took Sarah. But God came to Abimelech in a dream by night.